Sundays are fine days just to praise the Lord. Gather in the church and listen to His word. And then on Monday, though the skies be gray, He'll send the sunshine that will make you say, I feel like shouting, shout, glory to the Lord. Glory to the Lord forevermore. I feel like singing, singing, praise to His name. Praises like I've never sung before.
Some morning yonder heaven's gates of pearl will swing open for me as I leave this old world. And while the ages roll, I'll be at home with friends and loved ones all around God's throne.
I feel like shouting, shouting, glory to the Lord. Glory to the Lord forevermore. I feel like singing, singing, praise to His name. Praise like I've never sung before.
Shout,
shout, glory to the Lord, glory to the Lord forevermore.
I feel like singing,
sing,
singing,
sing, praise to His name, praise like I've never sung before. Singing, singing, shouting, shouting, glory.
What a great way to begin our time together. Did you catch the words? And then on Monday, though the skies be gray, You, Lord, send the sunshine that will make me say, I feel like shouting glory to the Lord. You know, one of the wonderful things about the reality of what we're experiencing today is for you and I, we still have to go through those Mondays where sometimes the clouds are gray. For Betty, every day is Sunday and Resurrection Day. It's over. This journey is over. And that's why she's shouting, and that's why someday we will too. So thank you. Welcome. Thank you on behalf of Gordon and the family. What a tribute and what a joy to be with you. Thank you. She left us great memories. She left us a great faith. And it's that faith that we especially want to celebrate today. It made her who she was as a woman. And then God took her special gifting and she lived it out in front of people in wonderful, incredible ways, including with her husband, Gordon. So thank you again for being here. There's going to be an opportunity to share later on. I'm going to read some memories from Gordon and from friends, and then I'm going to open it up to those of you that just may have a memory of Betty that just you can't stand to keep to yourself. And so be prepared for that and be thinking of that. If you'd like to be a part of that, you'd certainly be welcome to. By the way, this CD that Gordon has made a gift to me, the church, actually, he gave it to me a couple months ago. He said, I want to use it because they have like hundreds of CDs, and this was one she really loved, they really liked to listen to. I actually used this in another memorial service. Someone said, oh, I want some gospel music. And I said, I got the CD for you. So it already has been played twice now, and you're going to hear some more music today. This is Feeling Fine. It's the Old Friends Quartet. The last thing Gordon wanted me to remind you of was that if you want to give a gift in Betty's memory, they would like it to go to Nazarene Compassionate Ministries. They've supported that ministry for a long time, and anything that comes in for them will go to NCM. And you can actually just write it to us. If you just let me know that you want to give in Betty's name and you want to give to NCM, we'll take care of it. You just let me know, get it to me here, and I'll make sure it gets back to the right people. We're going to end the service at the very last words of Proverbs. So let me open it with the very first words. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, King of Israel. to know wisdom and instruction, to understand words of insight, to receive instruction in wise dealing, in righteousness, justice, and equity. That wisdom begins with knowing and putting your faith in the one who gave us that wisdom, which is the creator of our world and our creator. That's why we celebrate today, because early on in her life, Betty made a decision to exercise that wisdom and put her faith in Jesus. And because of that, she's whole. And because of him, we can know him too, and someday have a great reunion and see Betty and the people that we have loved so dearly again. So, Father, thank you. Thank you for a few moments that you've given us together. Thank you for Betty. Thank you for the life that she lived and for the faith that she put on display. Father, thank you for Gordon. Would you be especially close to him in these moments and in the days to come as life is just suddenly without his Betty? And then, Father, encourage us by your Holy Spirit as we remember some things today about the wisdom she put on display. We love you, Father, and bless you. In your Son's name, amen.
You can take all my possessions, all the things that men hold dear, all the precious gifts that this whole world can hold. But the love I found at Calvary far exceeds my fondest dreams. It's a love that can't be bought by this world's gold. Then you ask me why I love him, why I choose to walk this way. Well, his presence, it grows sweeter every day. It's the only life worth living. He has made our home complete. Then each night, round sundown, my girls all gather round. When the clouds of gloom and doubt would hover low, and they'd say, "Dad, we really love you." And my doubts just seem so small. He's made our home a heaven here below. Then you ask me why I love him, why I choose to walk this way. Well, his presence, it grows sweeter every day. It's the only life worth living. He has made our home complete. Jesus, he's all the world to me.
These are memories that Gordon shared with Linda Neff, and thank you, Linda, for helping us put this together for this moment. But Gordon said once released from his military duties, he began to ponder the idea of finding a mate. He thought it was going to be difficult because he was approaching 30 and she had to be a Christian woman. Gordon was at the 10-year class reunion in Dallas City Park when a friend of his named Jill said, "I think I have somebody in mind that you might like." And she gave Gordon the phone number of Betty. She was a teacher at Highland Elementary School, and she worked during the day. Gordon worked the night shift at the lumber mill, and he was involved regularly in a bowling league also in the evening, so it didn't happen very easily. But Jill never gave up. She kept calling Gordon and reminding him to make that call. And Gordon kept stalling. And then it started to snow. One night, it snowed 17 inches. And Gordon thought this might be the Lord talking to him. And he began to worry that Betty might be stranded. So the streets in Salem were plowed, but that was about it. She wouldn't be able to get to her parents' home in Sio. And so Gordon called her, and he asked if she was busy on Saturday, he would drive his pickup with chains on it. And so they did that, and they drove around Salem to look at the snow. On the next day, he picked her up in his brand new Riviera, and they went to Portland to spend some time at the Lloyd Center. The Lord was planning everything out for Gordon. If you ever sit with Gordon and talk to him about his life, he was in my office last week, a couple days. And in the short time we shared, if he said it once, he said it six times. He said, "Jerry," said, "the Lord was planning everything out." He just saw God's hand in the way he lived out his life, including in the way God brought him together with Betty. A month later, the parents wanted to meet Gordon, and it all worked out perfectly. After passing the parental interview, he asked Betty if she would like to go to the Salt Creek Baptist Church where Gordon had been attending. He had found out other people were also recommending the same church, so they started there. And then he thought he would take Betty fishing. And once they got to his spot, he left Betty alone. Fisher people do things like that. But Betty had kind of pre-thought about what might happen, and so she had a book with her to occupy her time. However, Gordon ended up being gone so long, she began to think he had gone off and left her. And Gordon said, well, that wasn't possible because he had the keys and had to go back to where they had parked the car. In the spring, Betty's parents invited him to go to Brighton Bush to go camping. And Gordon discovered a new fishing buddy in Betty's dad. And all summer they fished, including the Alsay River, and with both sets of parents. One of their camping trips to the beach, Gordon chickened out the first night in his proposal to Betty. The second night he got up the courage and he proposed while sitting on a cedar log. And Betty turned to him and said, "How much money do you have?" Wisdom. And he said, $3,000 and a new Riviera. And Betty said, "That's enough." So all the parents were excited, and a date was set for October the 11th. It was a short amount of time to get ready. She couldn't find her wedding dress in that time. So Jim and Judy, and this is Jim and Judy Schmicke, if you know that family, they were close friends, and Judy offered Betty the dress she had worn to her wedding. Now everything was set. So H.B. London was the new pastor at Salem First Nazarene, and he performed their ceremony. They took a week off and went to the Redwoods and the Rogue River. And on the return trip home, they decided to take turns driving, so if the other one that got tired, they could take a nap. And so Gordon knocked out when it was her turn to drive, and he said, "When I woke up, Betty was going 105 miles per hour." So, while on the job at Highland, Betty was asked to take over the school library. Betty was never one to do things halfway, so she went back to school to get her bachelor's degree in library sciences. And when asked, she also took over the management of First Nazarene's library, a job in which she was very thorough and one she loved. Betty never did anything halfway. She accepted the responsibilities of planning serendipity, Sunday school class parties, always going the extra yard. She was detail-oriented. And for the Christmas party, that included reserving the facility, selecting a menu that would please everyone, name tags, entertainment, one of the pastors to lead them in a short message, and wrapped thank you gifts for every person, each one who had been involved in helping them. After she was diagnosed with cancer, she passed all of this along on her notes that she had saved across the years. She was much loved and will be greatly missed by everyone. She had a 51-year relationship with Marvis Wall. They met in college, and Marvis shared some of her memories of Betty. She said, "My name is Marvis Wall, and I met Betty my freshman year at Northwest Nazarene College, now NNU, in Nampa, Idaho. We spent the next 3 years in the same dorm doing pretty much the same things. As we got acquainted, we found out we had similar backgrounds. We were both from small communities, small Nazarene churches, small local schools, and strong families. And as she was an only child, and I was the youngest of three, we were, quote, a little bit spoiled as young girls. She graduated and moved to Salem, where she worked for the Salem-Keizer School District as a librarian at the Highland Elementary School. And when my husband Jim graduated 1 year later, we moved to Salem and reconnected with Betty at Salem First Church of the Nazarene. She and her two roommates were so gracious to us as we were new to Oregon, new to Salem, new to marriage, and new to our jobs. And when she married Gordon, we continued our close friendship with both of them for the next 50 plus years. Early on, she shared with me that she faithfully kept a daily diary, and every night she would encircle the one thing for which she was most grateful. That was the undercurrent of her life, seeing the positive and focusing on being thankful. This attitude of gratitude was telling in every relationship she had, whether it was in the church or on the job or with family and friends. Her mantra was always live so you have no regrets. Betty would do anything for a friend. For us, that meant cleaning a rented apartment in Lake Oswego so we could live there for a few weeks following my liver transplant at Oregon Health Science University. She would take the time to listen in person, on the phone, in the car. She would cry with me, laugh with me, but not always agree with me. She could confront in a healing way. Another thing Betty and I shared was having strong mothers who greatly influenced our love for Jesus. It was a privilege to know her mom, Ruby, especially after Ruby moved to Salem to be closer to Betty and Gordon. Shortly before Betty died, I thanked her for sharing her mom with me, and we spoke of the blessings God gave us through our parents. An additional thing we had in common was that we each married strong German Christian men. We loved Gordon from the first. He was her best friend forever and always. Thank you, Gordon, for always being faithful and caring for your little bit spoiled girl. May you be blessed as you finish the journey we are taking, not only to see Jesus, but to see our precious friend, Betty, again. Thank you, Marvis, for doing that. I want to take a few moments and allow you maybe to share some thoughts you have before we do our next song.
Thank you. My name is Linda Neff, and this is my husband, Jerry. And we came to know Gordon and Betty through Serendipity Sunday School class. And we grew to love them immensely. I loved the fact that Betty was so oriented to detail. I quickly gave her a nickname, and she was always known to me as Betty Boop. And my last words to her in the hospital were addressing her as Betty Boop, and I got a little tiny upturn of her lower lip, and I knew that she was hearing. And so she always, like I said, like you mentioned, the Christmas party, she had everything down to the tiniest little detail. And I started doing cookie exchanges, and she decided she wanted to help. And ours was a little bit different. People brought in boxes of cookies, and we took them away, and we joked about they would never see them again, but we went in the garage where we had empty boxes set up, and Betty and I would go around and disperse all the cookies so people had boxes that were all alike. And then she started with an uh-oh, and I said, what does uh-oh mean? And she said, a broken one, I have to eat it. Well, we began to have a lot of uh-ohs in our sorting of the cookies. And she was just so much fun to be with. And she always was very gracious in giving me a little thank you gift that I would find on the counter someplace the next day. And so this particular time, she gave me two little snowmen ornaments, and they had our names on them, or so I thought. One of them was Jerry, and one was Lisa. And I thought, oh, who is Lisa? And so I called her up the next day, and I said, gee, that was really thoughtful, Betty. Thank you very much, but who's Lisa? And she said, what are you talking about? Now, if you know Betty, she had a way of just howling if something went wrong with an oh, no. And so I said, well, one says Jerry, and one says Lisa. And she proceeded to howl. And I said, well, the only problem is I don't know how this is going to go down in history in our family because the kids are going to want to know who Lisa is. I loved Betty, and I'm going to miss her.
Thank you, Linda. How about over here? Anyone over here?
I'm Flo Center, and I met Betty here in the sanctuary and really got to know her. And occasionally, some of my Sunday school duties, I would have to walk down the back aisle, and I always saw her sitting in the library. And I got a little tickled sometimes, and I had to go back down and drop off the Sunday school book. One day, I stuck my head in there, and I asked her, or I was singing, I forget which, Marion the librarian. And she just tickled, she was tickled beyond everywhere. So every day then, when I saw her, and I go, how's Marion the librarian?
Anyone else? This way. My apologies, I should have started with family.
I am Betty's sister-in-law, and I One of my memories that stands out so much is after my husband died, they took me to Coos Bay, and we got to visit Shore Acres with all the brilliant lights, and we had such a good time, and I'm just thankful for her.
Thank you. Any other family?
Yeah. I'm Stacy Fry. I am Gordon and Betty's niece-in-law. My memory of Betty is shortly after my husband and I were married for 3 weeks, and she shared with me this handy tip that I've used for 21 years. When he gets up to go get a coffee or water, while you're up, could you grab me a glass of water? Since you're up, could you grab me a cookie? So I have learned that shortly after I met her, and I use that all the time. My poor husband.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Judy Spitke, and this is my husband, Dick. And Dick and Gordon were good friends. They grew up together at Salt Creek Baptist Church. Oh, there's Jerry and Linda. Hi. Anyway, so there was a lot of times that we would get together with Gordon and Betty, go out to dinner and stuff before we had children. And anyway, I'm the one that wore the wedding gown first. And she asked me if she could borrow it. And I said, sure. So anyway, we shared that in common. That was pretty fun. And one of the things I remembered about Betty was her steadfast faith. Now, you may not think, some of you younger people may not think faith is very important, but just let me tell you, the closer you get to our age, it's real, real important, because you don't know if God's going to give you another day, another week, or another hour. We just never know. But one thing Betty knew is her hope was in Jesus. And also, I want to say thank you to Peggy Biggins, because Dick and Peggy were in school, and I've heard about her piano music, and now I got to hear it, and she's pretty great. You guys are lucky, or I should say blessed. But anyway, one of the things Betty shared about teaching, she taught at Highland, and for a while our kids were at Highland Elementary in Salem before we moved to Portland area, and she told about a little ornery boy that was in the school, and during recess, I think it was must have been noon recess, the train would come by the playground. Maybe some of you heard the story before, but anyway, that kid jumped the train. The teachers didn't miss him too bad, actually. They were kind of glad he jumped the train. But no, they caught up with him in Eugene, I guess. But anyway, I thought, you know, we laughed about that because kids are kids. They'll do what they do. But Betty was a wonderful, fun person. She just had a positive attitude. And she could have griped a lot about her situation, but she sure didn't. I never heard her anytime we visited. And I thought, wow, you know, that's truly proof positive that Jesus is real. And no matter what your circumstance, no matter what, he's in it to the end with us. So if you don't know Jesus, I'd advise you check him out.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Thank you. I'm Sharon Klassen. This is my husband, Howard. And I didn't get to know Betty very well. But what time I did spend with her, she always had something very positive and enthusiastic to say about her husband and what a good husband he was to cook and clean and do all the things that he did for her so she could take better care of herself to take care of him in return. So it was a very loving, caring relationship. And I'm thankful that I had the opportunity to know them both. And Howard and Gordon spent a lot of time growing up together and fishing and probably telling lots of stories. And I'm not so sure how truthful they were, but I'm sure there was a lot of laughing.
Rick, let's go. Here you go.
I'm Jolene Boyd, and years ago, we only have one son, and when he was away, college and working in California, holidays became kind of lonely, and so we thought of asking people, and we asked people all over the church, you know, again and again, we heard, no, but thank you. No, we're set. And so all of a sudden, I thought about these people named Harold and Howard.
What's his name?
Gordon and Betty. And sorry, Gordon. And they were really complete strangers to us, but we braved it and went up to them and said, hey, bet you're alone too. Do you want to join us? And at that time, Gordon's brother was very ill, and they needed to pay attention to that. But you know, they just thought that was so special that we would even think about inviting them, that they kind of latched themselves onto us. And so we've been stuck with them ever since. And we just loved it, and especially when Betty got her diagnosis, I was on the calling committee anyway, and I really enjoyed praying for her, and it was my privilege to communicate whenever I could. And one time, I have this thing recently, within the last few years, that Christians should never fear, because that doesn't come from God. And so I kind of taught that everywhere I went. And I wanted to make sure that Betty wasn't in a fit of fear. And so I wrote a very, 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 very long email to her with a lot of scripture and things like that. And she then the next time we talked, she said, I don't have any of that, Jolene. I only have peace.
I'm Pat Brumman, and my husband and I, Carl, did greeting at the front door of the church for probably a couple of years or more, and Betty used to come through our door, and she was always so cheerful. As you know already, she was in charge of the church library for a while, and I contributed a bunch of Christian novels. I like Karen Kingsbury, and so I would contribute those books. And so one Sunday she came through the door and she said, well, good morning, Mrs. Kingsbury. And that became my name ever after. She was such a sweetheart.
What else? It's okay, Peggy.
I'm Peggy Delaney, and this is my husband, Gary. We first met Betty and Gordon when she was in the hospital, and as we were doing visitation and calling. And it can be kind of awkward to meet someone for the first time when they're in a hospital bed, but we set our foot in her hospital room, and she brightened and she greeted us so warmly as though she'd known us forever. And that just is remarkable, and we appreciated that. And we got to visit with her quite a bit. Unfortunately, when she was in Salem Transitional for so long, we would see them every week and a half or so, and felt like we made new friends.
Thanks to Calvary,
I'm glad to be replying, because I'm testifying to tell you how I'm getting along. Today I'm fine, thanks to Calvary. I'm safe,
I'm safe
for
you.
I walk with the one I adore. My life was once so meaningless, so empty and sad. I wandered here and there with a tide. But since I know redeeming bliss that I never had, my life has got a purpose.
The Lord is my God.
A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. It was appropriate to start the service with, I feel like shouting. I've made a lot of calls on a lot of people across the years. But nobody ever screamed when I came through the door except Betty. And it happened a couple of times, I got to where I'd get to the door and I'd go, "It's just me, don't scream." And she just loved people. She loved people that cared. She loved people, you know, that were just, she knew was praying for her in her last few years, were filled with its share of challenges. She wrote me as many encouraging cards, or us, actually, as anyone in the church. We were talking about it, and Kathy had one that she had written around Thanksgiving of 5 years ago, 2017. She said, "We appreciate you. We know you care for countless tasks and details for our church family and handle them with grace and love. Thank you." She said, "Of course, we especially are grateful for your support for the church library program. So have a wonderful Thanksgiving." My wife said this morning, she said, I will never forget walking down the hall in the library and you would see Betty, and she said she would give you a smile that was so beautiful. It would just light up the room. Proverbs, the scroll of Proverbs, is a call to wisdom. It's a wisdom that actually was on display in the creation narrative and in the creation scenario itself. We're told that wisdom was put on display as creation was made by God. It was a wisdom that creator sought to give to all humanity, because it's a reflection of what it looks like to live out God's wisdom in a world that largely has forgotten it or doesn't care about it. But it's an invitation to reflect on what it's like to know God's wisdom and then to live it out in your life. And it's interesting because the scroll itself begins with a father's wisdom from a father to his son. And it ends with the son's reflection on the wisdom he received from his mother. And then the last verses from 10 to 31 is a piece of poetry. And the writer has made it an acrostic. It's based on the Hebrew alphabet. And so I'm going to do something today that I've never done in a funeral or memorial service. But as I thought about Betty, I'm going to use her name as an acrostic for some points that I want to make from her life and from the book of Proverbs. We start with B, for beauty. Proverbs 31:30 says, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Betty had a beauty that extended well beyond her outward appearance. That beauty, as people already mentioned, was reflected because of her faith in Jesus and what his Spirit did in her as she lived out her life, faithfully doing her best to reflect the beauty of the Lord. It's a beauty within. And it's a beauty that God aims for all of us, primarily, because so often the world is obsessed with outward appearances. Peter said, your beauty should not come from outward adornments, such as braided hair and the wearing of gold jewelry, fine clothes. Instead, it should be that of your inner self, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of great worth in God's sight. The E is for empathy, because she cared deeply about others. That too was reflected in the memories of both Gordon and Marvis shared. She was a person, as Peggy said, who once she knew you, you became a close friend. And she was interested in you and interested in your life and wanting to do what she could do to be of any help or encouragement to you. The third was her testimony. In Proverbs 31:20, it says, she opens her arm to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. She lived out her life. She lived it out at home in the way that she cared for Gordon. She lived it out here in how she interacted with all of you and how she involved herself in the ministry of the church for the sake of making it more than it was, because the church is the sum total of all that we give to it, and she wanted to make sure that she added value with the gifts and the abilities that God had given her. And she did it at work. And how she operated out there in the world, the testimony that she left to people who knew, because they knew she knew Jesus. She wanted to make sure that what they knew about Jesus through her was going to be as good as it could possibly be. The second T would be total commitment. And it wasn't just to the Lord. It was to Gordon. When you heard them tell their stories, it was not a perfect relationship, but it was a relationship reflective of two people that loved Jesus and were determined and committed to taking care of each other for as long as they could. His faithfulness when she was not able to be at home. Gordon lived largely alone the last few years. He was always there. He was always going to make sure she was cared for. And she had that commitment in her faith to Jesus, but to Gordon as well. Proverbs 31:11 says her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. Her commitment never failed. Her faith, as you mentioned, Her faith was strong. The challenges that she came would test that commitment and that faith, but never once did Betty ever express anything to me, but that as difficult as the circumstances were, she knew God was in the middle of it. And as Gordon had said many times, she knew God's purposes and plans, even when they involved this kind of challenge, that God was there. And there was purpose in the challenge. There's purpose in the suffering. And finally, the why would be for youthfulness. Proverbs 31:25 says, she is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. Her ultimate hope, and someone said this too, her ultimate hope was never in this life lasting forever. And there's an appearance, and all of us, most of us here today, can appreciate the fact that there seems to be, with at least some of us, I'll point to myself, there seems to be in this room, it appears that some of us are aging. It's an appearance. It's a body that someday you and I will take off like a piece of clothing. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15 that a moment is coming when you and I will be clothed with something new. This shell of who we are that we someday will take off and that Betty has taken off, someday in his return to earth, there will be a great resurrection. And you and I will be clothed with something new, something eternal, something with a glory not seen since the day that Jesus walked out of that tomb on resurrection morning. But Betty had a youthful spirit. It didn't matter. I like to say, I may be getting older, but I don't have to grow up. And the truth is, in my spirit and in her spirit, I want to maintain a youthful enthusiasm. There was a youthful vigor. With Betty just below the surface, there was always something kind of waiting to explode in the moment. But the reality was, she knew that beyond this life, there was an eternal youthfulness that she would enjoy forever because she had put her faith in the one who had conquered death. And in that conquering Savior, Jesus, she found the one that would become the ballast for her life and the foundation of all she believed. And she knew that day would come when she would find the youthfulness God has in store for us all. A wife of noble character, who can find? She's worth far more than rubies. Charm is deceptive. Beauty is fleeting. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done. And let her works bring her praise at the city gate. So Betty was not perfect in her execution. None of us are. None of us ever will be this side of heaven. But Betty was perfect in her heart to do her best to honor Jesus, his saving grace, and his presence within her to be all that she could come until she met him face to face. And she would say, the very heart of wisdom is acknowledging the one who created us, is the one who died for us, and is the one who was raised from the dead, become the very first fruits of them that pass away. And Betty now has joined the ranks of people that on that side await the return of Jesus just as much as we do. for that final, ultimate restoration. And she would say, keep a perfect heart in everything you do. Do your best to reflect Jesus until we see him again.
Oh, I'm weary and tired. I just want to rest. My labor is o'er.
I want to rest.
My labor's o'er.
Oh, Lordy, I'm going someday to that peaceful shore.
My labor is o'er, and I'm going someday to that beautiful shore.
Oh, where I'll
die.
I know more.
I'll die no more.
I know that soon I'll be gone. No way of knowing when I shall cross Jordan's bone.
I'll cross Jordan's bone.
But I know that soon I'll awake under that star.
Close in prayer and bless you. I'm going to have Bill come and escort the family. If you would just wait until they're out in the lobby, and then I'll dismiss all of you to go meet and greet with them. But let me say thank you again. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your prayers. Keep praying. Keep praying. And don't ever feel like you can't call Gordon and go, how are you doing? Because for him, life is different. He's in a new season. It's a season of waiting. He continues to wait, but it is a new season. So encourage him. Don't be afraid to do that in the weeks and months ahead. So, Father, thank you. Thank you for Betty. Thank you for her life and her faith. It remains a witness and a testimony to us today and until your son returns. May the memories bring great joy. Father, be especially close to Gordon. Comfort him as only you can. Bless him, Father, as he begins this new season of life. Be with her family and be with her friends. Each time someone leaves us, Lord, we're reminded of our ultimate hope, and we yearn all the more for your son's return. May it be soon. But until it happens, help us, Lord, to be faithful, to walk in his ways and in his wisdom. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
You're dismissed, family.